Well, I would say things have gotten a little bit busy over in Darlington County because Darlington is on the clock. The Goodyear 400 coming up this weekend, Mother's Day weekend, throwback weekend. Fans are arriving. Josh Harris, president of Darlington, is joining us. Josh, great to have you with us. I know your predecessor, the early part of the week of race week, we would talk to him, and he would have a broom in his hands out sweeping the track and tweezers in his hand out pulling weeds from the grass, just making everything look perfect. I know you're doing the same thing.
That's right. You know, we've got everybody all hands on deck, and we've been out making sure the place looks great. Our team's done a great job. We welcomed our first campers to the track this morning, and it's been a busy day. Got through a little bit of wet weather early this morning and got their campgrounds open, and it's been a beautiful day since.
Let's talk about what happened this past weekend real quick before we get to Darlington, because a little bit of history was stolen from you this past weekend.
Yeah, you know, we one race shy of my first one, and we lose the record. I can't believe it, but no, great race at Kansas over the weekend on Saturday especially. You know, the race as a whole was really competitive throughout, really fun to watch. And then certainly the end was quite spectacular. And yeah, we gave it a good ride for 21 years holding that record. And maybe we'll go after it again this Sunday.
Well, I would say that the difference is, at least in your race, the two cars were banging and connected to one another as they crossed. Maybe you can go with the record, not necessarily the front of the car, but the distance between the two cars. You probably have the record of the closeness of two cars crossing the line at the same time, since they were basically connected to one another.
Yeah, that's right. You know, they pretty much beat and banged all the way down that from the middle of that turn three and four all the way around the front stretch of the start-finish line. So, you know, Larson and Buescher, they banged off each other a couple of times, but they kind of got away from each other, so we'll keep that one in our cap.
There you go. One quick question on strategy. We were talking about this last night. Of course, I don't think either one of us smart enough to figure it out, and I'm sure my perception is totally wrong here, but I was just wondering, you know, you're Martin Truex, and he was the one guy of the leaders who had enough gas where he didn't have to feather the throttle. He could keep the pedal to the metal. At least that's what the announcers were saying. And so the caution comes out, and everybody hits the pits. If you're Martin Truex, though, and you're the crew chief, why wouldn't you make a call to stay out? Because you've got enough fuel, track position. I would imagine you'd be the leader going to the green flag. Is it a case where that was irrelevant, that he had enough fuel because the fresher tires are going to make the difference, and he would have been passed? By the time they got to the checkers, because the other cars were on fresher tires, and they would have made up the distance?
Yeah, that's exactly right. You know, we've had a number of races this year where tire wear hasn't been much of a factor, but there was a great combination of tire wear on Sunday at Kansas. And Martin, had they stayed out, yeah, they'd have been caught in two laps. And kind of the flip side of that is, you know, Martin came in and they actually took four tires, whereas some of the guys only took two. And had that race been another lap or two instead of just a green white checkered, Martin probably would have passed them on four fresh tires. So I think if he had stayed out there on his old tires, he would have had to do a lot of blocking. And by the time they came around for that white flag lap, he likely would have lost several positions. So I think they made the right call to pit. The two tire versus four tire, I think, ultimately put a couple other guys out front, and they were able to hold them off for that two-lap shootout.
Mm-hmm.
Josh Harris, president of Darlington Raceway, on the clock for the Goodyear 400 coming out this Sunday at the Lady in Black. And Josh, we'll give you a minute, if you will, just kind of lay out what the pre-race festivities the next couple of days leading up to the Trucks on Friday, Xfinity on Saturday, and, of course, the Cup Series on Sunday. What's happening at the track the next few days?
Yeah, we've got, like I said, we open up the campgrounds today. We're going to get out in the campgrounds the next couple of days and do some activities with our campers. And then really Thursday is a busy day. We've got the American, the blood drive here with the American Red Cross. So 12 to 6 right out in front of our ticket office administration building. You can come give blood, great opportunity. And then Thursday evening, 6:30 to 8, we're doing our track laps for charity. So for $25, you can come out and be the first cars on the track this weekend for three laps, about an hour and a half. It's going to Darlington Shares, our charitable foundation. So that's going to get us kicked off before we get to Friday. We open the fan zone and we have the NASCAR experience. We've got vintage stock cars on display, a lot of activities for our fans in the fan zone. And then I'll roll right into a busy weekend with former drivers here doing Q&As, autograph sessions. We got the throwback parade on Saturday after the NASCAR Xfinity Series race, and then we cap it all off with the Goodyear 400 on Sunday. So busy, busy weekend. Teams, like I said, we've worked hard. A lot of planning and details have gone into it, and we're excited that it's here.
Josh, since this is your first opportunity to oversee Throwback Weekend, what are your takeaways from it? Because I've got an interesting point I wanted to bring up after I get your assessment, because Denny Hamlin had some interesting comments to say earlier this week about the future of Throwback Weekend.
Yeah, you know, for me, coming in, being part of it last year, was celebrating NASCAR's 75th anniversary and the top 75 drivers was a really cool moment. We're kind of back to the normal Throwback Weekend, so to speak. It's the 10th year of the Throwback platform. So I'm excited. It's so fun to be part of seeing the history of the sport recognized and celebrated, you know, in so many different forms. The paint schemes that the teams throw back to is obviously a big draw for the fans. We got the fan vote launched yesterday, so fans can vote for their favorite paint scheme. And then the opportunity just to welcome back former drivers, former competitors to be here around the weekend is a really special opportunity that we have at Darlington. You know, I can't think of a better track to host kind of a reunion of sorts for NASCAR every year than right here at Darlington. And then, you know, as we look forward, you know, I haven't heard what Denny has said, so I'm interested to hear. But, you know, as we look forward, 2025, we will celebrate the track's 75th anniversary. So that'll be a cool moment for us all throughout the year. So as far as I'm concerned, Throwback Weekend has a home here at Darlington. We're going to continue to celebrate it and honor the history while also, you know, having some great racing in the present.
Good to hear, because Denny Hamlin on his own podcast said, I guess yesterday or earlier this week, that he felt like this could actually be the final Throwback Weekend at Darlington, adding that it's kind of lost its luster. What would you say to Denny when you get an opportunity to speak with him this week about that?
Well, you know, everybody's entitled to their opinion, and Denny has run some really cool throwback schemes over the years. I would say, you know, what is it that he feels like we could do? He's obviously a big advocate, has a big platform. You know, what are the things that made it so special that maybe we've you know, missed here and there? So I know just from what I see and experience, it still means a lot to the fans that come out here. The first couple of years of any platform are always, you know, hard to replicate in years past, but I do think this is, you know, a unique platform that gives us a chance every year to really look back and celebrate our history at a historic track. You know, Kerry has said it over the years, other people, it's kind of like our Wrigley Field or our Fenway Park. You know, that's what we've got here. We can celebrate the past while having some of the best racing that we put on today right here at Darlington. So as far as I'm concerned, we're going to continue to have it. We want the drivers and the teams to participate. And if there's an opportunity to sit down and get Denny's thoughts on it, I'm sure we'll try to do that this weekend.
Couple more minutes with Josh Harris from Darlington. Take us to Sunday afternoon leading up to drivers start your engines from Ray Evernham. What's the program going to look like there on the front stretch there in front of the big stands? What do you have plans as far as singing national anthem and flyovers or anything like that leading up to the start?
Yeah, so we'll have some more information about our national anthem coming out this week, but it'll have a military component to it. We're working on our flyover right now. We'll have one for sure on Sunday. So those are all those spectacle things that we have become known for at NASCAR events, and we're going to continue to have that leading into the start of the race on our pre-race stage. We're going to have several Q&As down there with our current drivers. That'll be fun for the fans to take in, some DJ playing, some music, sign the start-finish line. And then outside the track in the fan zone, really where a lot of activity will take place with more Q&As, Q&As with our former drivers that'll be here, the legends of the sport. So I'm really excited about that. Different partner interactive displays, really just a way to take it in. We're going to do mimosas for mom, kind of a brunch time frame at our little porta bar in the fan zone. So mom's out celebrating Mother's Day. Come by, grab a mimosa. We'll cheers to them. And, you know, it's a special day for all of our moms.
That's fantastic.
That's awesome.
One more thing before we let you go. Big story on the – this is, does involve you guys, of course, but, I mean, it does involve racing. Big story on the Indy side, the Formula One side, where the Penske team, three of them were caught, you know, manipulating their cars in races, I think in St. Petersburg. And they put these things in their cars that went around what the Indy officials were able to control, et cetera, about, you know, boosting the cars in restarts and things like that. So anyway, you know, they got hammered pretty hard by Indy people. Just your thoughts about that and the technology involved and, you know, kind of what they were trying to do, if you're familiar with that story.
Yeah, you know, I've heard a little bit about it. Our focus has really been here over the last few weeks. I've read a little. I don't fully understand what all that Formula One and Indy cars have in terms of this push to pass or extra boost or anything, but I know we don't have that in NASCAR, and it's one of those things. It probably becomes a little bit of a slippery slope. You know, from what I saw, the Penske organization stepped up and took responsibility. So, you know, suspended some team members, and ultimately, I think that's kind of what you have to do if you have a mistake like this, whether intentional or not. It gets discovered. You know, ultimately, someone has to be held responsible, and it looks like that's what they've done. So, that's all I really know about it. You know, again, I haven't dug too much into it. And one of those things that as technology continues to advance in motorsports, it's probably just one of those things that has happened. And it may happen again. Everybody's always looking for that fine line that they can rub right up against to try to find some speed.
Yeah, the winner of the race in St. Petersburg, whose name escapes me, I mean, they stripped him of that victory. So they really came down hard, and I think Penske was really embarrassed by this happening within his teams. You know, I think he's a pretty much a stickler for the rules with his guys. So, all right, well, listen, look forward to seeing you this weekend. Come stick your head in the old press box there on turn three if you get a chance, because that's where we'll be hunkering down throughout the race on Sunday. Look forward to seeing you if we can.
Thanks, Josh.
Yes, sir. I'll see you guys there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Great meeting with Josh Harris, president of Darlington. You know he's excited, Chris, about running his first race weekend.
Oh, yeah.
Excited and nervous about everything coming off, you know, on schedule, on time, et cetera.
Yeah, but they run that like such a well-oiled machine, and he's got a good crew, and having Russell Branham back in the mix over there just to bring back some history and some veteran presence in there, I think Josh will do a phenomenal job. I just thought the comments by Denny Hamlin were fascinating on his podcast. It's called Actions Detrimental. And quite frankly, I'm not sure Denny's that far off, Phil. I've said for years once they moved it off of the Southern 500, I didn't see the allure to throwback weekend. To me, it had to be your throwback race, and that was Labor Day weekend. Mm-hmm. I understand you can tell me, well, they wanted their guys for the playoffs. They wanted the big advertising for the playoffs. Well, Darlington's not in the playoffs this year. I get it. Moving it back is difficult to do, but Hamlin said, you know, it was really cool the first year everyone bought in, and it was very similar to eras in certain decades, but it's kind of all over the board now. And he said, I'd be surprised if this goes past this year.
Hmm. You know, I get what he's saying. Things get stale. You do them over and over again. It's like their all-star race. I mean, the NASCAR all-star race has gotten stale. I mean, it's the same drivers that you see every week, just in a different race with a funky format, you know, and they try to throw some things in there to make it different. But that's somewhat kind of a – but, I mean, I guess, you know, going – maybe they revived it a little bit by going to the old tracks, going to North Wilkesboro.
Right.
Maybe they should go to Rockingham and do it there, you know, bring these tracks back to life a little bit. I don't know, but – I hear what he's saying, and that's a
good
point.
Well, and to his point, and, you know, Josh and them this year, they're trying to celebrate the roots of racing. going back to, you know, the old dirt tracks and, you know, how these guys grew up. Well, if you look at some of the paint schemes, William Byron's paint scheme is a throwback to Jeff Gordon's car back in 2009, 11, and 2013. I mean, it's not going along the lines as to what Darlington was hoping to foster this weekend. So the teams, I think, are having in their defense, I think after a while it gets difficult to come up with new paint schemes and new throwback paint schemes. They've been doing this for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And if you enjoy the throwback paint scheme, you need to let Darlington know, because I get the feeling Denny Hamlin's probably not the only one in the garage that feels that way. He's just bold enough to say it.
Well, he's bold enough. He's definitely that.